F1 on ITV, sponsored by Shell V-Power.
Alonso versus Schumacher in Sao Paulo, the final duel, and for the greatest career in Formula One, the final countdown. In the late 80s and into the early 90s, Michael Schumacher was transformed from boy racer into Grand Prix superstar. There will be 91 victories, 7 world championships, reviving the fortunes of Ferrari. But now it's just the Brazilian Grand Prix between Schumacher and retirement.
Well, who knows what the future will bring. One thing I know is that for a while I will just relax and take it easy and think about my future, what that could be.
But this is the man who could rewrite the record book still further, especially if Fernando Alonso can claim his second world title at age 25.
Michael is more difficult because he needs to win and me out, but it's not impossible. And you know, until the last lap of the race, anything can happen.
And it did happen yesterday to Michael Schumacher. Engine problems at the start of the final qualifying session. And instead of his hoped-for pole position launching him to victory, Schumacher is back in 10th. The exit beckons, but they love their Formula One heroes in Sao Paulo. It's going to be a highly emotional Brazilian Grand Prix. Interlagos, one of Formula One's most atmospheric venues, a wholly appropriate place for the World Championship to be decided and its most talented star to bow out. And when there's a Brazilian on pole position, the passion of this near-capacity crowd reaches a whole new intensity as well. And that's exactly what we've got here today. Felipe Massa on pole position for Brazil and for Ferrari to put alongside everything else that's due to be decided and due to be celebrated at this Brazilian Grand Prix. The final round of an extraordinary Formula One World Championship that swung first from Alonso and then to Schumacher, and now it seems firmly back to Alonso once again. Because when you look at the Drivers' Championship, you see that having reclaimed the lead in the championship battle when Schumacher blew up in Japan 2 weeks ago, all Alonso needs today is a single point to successfully defend the title he won last year. Schumacher, in contrast, has to win the race and see Alonso finish out of the points to become champion for the 8th time. But Schumacher is 10th on the grid and Alonso is 4th. And Renault, firm favourites to successfully defend the Constructors' Championship, even with Felipe Massa on pole for Ferrari, Alonso and Fisichella are well placed for the solid points finish that is all that Renault require. But Mark Blundell, it's not won yet, although there's a very good atmosphere in the Renault garage here. The one thing that we've learned from this season is don't take anything for granted.
Exactly that. You cannot take anything for granted. This team especially, they've got nothing to worry about at this point. But come the race, there may be a little gremlin that comes in. We've seen it only a race ago with Michael Schumacher in the engine. But I think they'll be fine. I think Renault have got the fingers crossed. But Ferrari got the pressure on. They need to deliver something for Michael Schumacher and get him up the front.
And what Fernando Alonso needs to do is stay out of trouble. And there is trouble lying in store around this very tight little circuit. Big crash for Alonso here 3 years ago.
Oh, you know, it's a big memory there for Alonso because he had a nasty accident. He came around the left-hander, a little bit blind there on the brow, run into another car. It's a big impact, Steve, and he's very lucky to get away with no injuries on it. But, you know, that's one of the things of this circuit. It can catch you out, especially into turn one off the start as well.
Now, conditions here today, the sun is out, it's significantly warmer, and that's not really to the advantage of Michelin in their final race in Formula 1.
It's not, and there's a big rumour kicking around that maybe these guys, Renault here, have picked the wrong tyre, actually, in terms of compound, maybe to their disadvantage, but Bridgestone, Ferrari, fingers crossed for them, they are very happy to see the sun out.
But qualifying, that was very much to the advantage of Fernando Alonso and Renault. Bad day for Michael Schumacher, and James Allen looks back at all the action of yesterday.
Felipe Massa starts this afternoon's Grand Prix from pole position, but unfortunately for him, the pole sitter here in Interlagos hasn't gone on to win the race for 8 years. It's a weird place and there's no such thing as a straight run to the flag. Michael Schumacher could tell him that. He was looking set fair for pole in his final Grand Prix after the second knockout qualifying session, but then in Quali 3, he had a fuel pressure problem, took no part in the session, and he will start 10th on the grid. The Bridgestones once again had stunning first lap pace. Jarno Trulli took advantage of that with third place on the grid ahead of Alonso and Rubens Barrichello. Jenson Button will view this very much as a missed opportunity though. He has the pace in this car to take on the Renaults for the first time this season. But unfortunately for him, a traction control problem meant he qualified in 14th place. Another very disappointed Brit is David Coulthard, a season worst 19th for the Scotsman who simply couldn't get a balance on his car. Alonso then needs only 1 point to win the World Championship. Back-to-back championships for him would be a stunning achievement, and he will be looking forward to scenes like this in a few hours' time. So, Felipe Massa's third career pole position, his second in a row after Suzuka. Raikkonen has finished second here on the podium for the past 2 seasons. Alonso once again has to deal with Jarno Trulli off the start line, but he says he won't take risks this time. Barrichello and Fisichella make up row 3. Ralf Schumacher was just a tenth of a second slower than Alonso, but he's 3 places behind him, Heidfeld alongside. Then it's Kubica and Michael Schumacher. He can win this race from 10th on the grid. Weber and De La Rosa make up row 6. Row 7, Rosberg and Jenson Button, who had a really fast car here, but was unlucky with traction control problems. The two Toro Rossos make up row 8. Row 9, Albers, the fastest of the spikers, ahead of Coulthard, who had a nightmare in qualifying. Sato and Yamamoto in his last Grand Prix for Super Aguri. And then it's Montero, who didn't set a lap. And Dornbos, who takes a 10-place drop for an engine penalty.
It's something really special for me. It's something really special for Brazilian people, because the Formula 1 is very traditional here. And today is definitely a fantastic day for me, and I will never forget.
We keep pushing and see what we can do. Hopefully we can at least keep the second place and finish strong.
The car has been growing up in the last few races, some improvement on the aero and on the mechanical side. On the other end, I think Bridgestone brought here some good tyres which performed very well in qualifying and even better for the race.
The same thing that happened to Michael's car today, it can happen to me tomorrow, and then you have to wait and see what is the final result.
If 9 cars go slower than myself and I can pass them, I can win. Pretty easy calculation. Let's see what happens.
Next door to Renault is McLaren, where we find the former world champion Mika Häkkinen. Mika, you're the man to tell us, how difficult will it be for Fernando Alonso today to just drive for the single point that he needs?
It's going to be mentally very, very difficult, Fernando, to get the 1 point, because it's just a nerve-cracking situation. Even though Michael is in a situation where he is, it must be. I mean, I know from the experience in the past years what I experienced, and it's a terrible feeling. But I hope him all the best, you know.
And you got your compatriot Kimi Raikkonen on the front row with Felipe Massa. How important would a win be for your old friends at McLaren?
I think the McLaren, Mercedes, and Kimi did the fantastic work yesterday. You know, they did the good qualifying, very clean qualifying. Starting second position, the victory would be very ideal for the team, for the Kimi. They need this victory. They need to win this race, my opinion. And I feel that way. They've been having an exciting relationship many years, and the great results. So now I wish they can they can finish it with middle of the podium.
Mika, thanks very much.
Thank you. Enjoy
the race and enjoy the afternoon.
Thanks.
So the bell is about to sound for the final round of a Formula One World Championship battle, which at times has seen like an all-out heavyweight boxing contest with the greatest champion that the sport has ever seen up against its great new star. And against all the expectations, Alonso against Schumacher has gone the distance.
In the red corner, seven times champion of the world, Michael Schumacher. In the blue corner, the reigning champion, Fernando Alonso.
What concerns the future that you don't worry too much about what just happened?
From the driver point of view, this is keeping you stressed all the time, and it's not fantastic, but hopefully the people on the TV enjoy.
Continues, racing continues, 11 races to go, 21 points behind, nowhere near than finished.
You're gonna kill him!
Just couldn't pull out the performance, just didn't go. By the rate and the speed and performance we have at this moment, it looks good.
It's true that if we keep going like this in three or four races, we will be equal in points, and this is not good for me. Until the last lap of the race, anything can happen.
Well, we have nothing to lose. The worst is we stay where we are.
Seconds out, final round.
Well, like any desperate contender, what Michael Schumacher has to do now is try to find somehow a spectacular final round knockout blow. All Fernando Alonso has to do is to stay out of trouble. Mind you, as you were seeing from that, at the halfway point of the season, well, Schumacher himself looked down and out, trailing Alonso by 25 points after Alonso won the Canadian Grand Prix in June. But that was his last victory until Japan 2 weeks ago. Schumacher was level after his win in China, but his blown engine in Japan gifted the win to Alonso and was salvation for Renault. A season of two halves, Mark, but exactly why?
I mean, basically because Renault came out the box strong at the beginning of the season. Alonso capitalised on that, started getting wins under his belt. They got their headway in the championship, their 25 points. But believe me, Ferrari clawed it back with Bridgestone, Michael Schumacher at the wheel. I think the big thing for me was Monte Carlo, where we had the little incident there with Schumacher. Cost him some points, which is so valuable at this point of the season. It would have been, you know, great to have seen that duel today. Unfortunately, it's not going to happen. But don't be alarmed, I think Schumacher's still going to come through.
Yes, what Schumacher would give, though, for Felipe Massa's pole position for this race this afternoon. And the young Brazilian has grown in stature and reputation and talent, especially during the second half of this season. And Martin Brundle now looks at his pole position lap yesterday around this Interlagos circuit.
The Autodromo Carlos Pache for the Brazilian Grand Prix, just on the outskirts of São Paulo. 2.66 miles. The only man that looked like he was capable of taking pole position here through free practice was Felipe Massa in the Ferrari. His car skimming along the ground, up to 200 miles an hour on the pit straight. Look for five downshifts as he sweeps into the apex of turn one, the Senna S ahead. full throttle through there. Tremendous grip and poise from the Ferrari. He'll ease it to the right-hand side. It'll build to 185 miles an hour. And look at the boards on the right where he's braking. Just 60 metres before the corner. Still the nose goes in beautifully and he stamps on the throttle pedal, bringing it gently to the left. For the double apex, Ferradura. About 160 on the way in. Kissed that apex for the second time. Over the top of the hill and immediately into Laranca. He mugs the curbs and throws it straight into the 70 mile an hour Pinarino. An armful of opposite lock to correct the Ferrari. Break in a straight line for Pico de Pacho, but not too much. Tuck it into the inside. We're catching the Williams through Mergulo. 160 miles an hour. The car's bolted to the ground. Don't break too late for Juncao. You'll simply bounce off the road, but do get on the throttle early to climb that hill. This anti-clockwise circuit simply wrenches the neck off the shoulders of the drivers. We're now getting in the slipstream of that car ahead and he's really giving us tremendous top speed as we go over the line at 110.6 for pole position.
Well, we're down here in the fantastically atmospheric Brazilian paddock, and Anthony, I wanted to ask you, if you were racing today, maybe in Ruben's position of fifth, would you be tempted just to throw one up the inside of Fernando?
Oh yeah, definitely. I mean, what's Ruben's got to lose, really? I mean, you know, home race for him. He's up there at the sharp end and hasn't had a race win this year yet. And he desperately wants to do that because he wants to get one over on Jensen as well. But if I was in his shoes, for sure you'd have a go. I mean, you know that Alonso is the weak guy out there. I mean, he's looking behind him everywhere. He's watching where Schumacher is and, yeah, watching the mirrors, only trying to score 1 point. Sounds easy enough, but when you're the hunted, it becomes quite difficult.
Okay, thanks very much, Anthony. And back to you, Steve.
Well, Ferrari, mighty encouraged by what Felipe Massa has achieved over the second half of the season. And Massa will, of course, be joined in this team by Kimi Raikkonen for 2007. And with Ross Brawn poised to announce at least his temporary departure, a new era dawns at Ferrari. But first of all, they have to say farewell to their greatest ever driver. His record may never be beaten. 91 Grand Prix wins, almost as many as Senna and Prost combined. Only Riccardo Patrese has contested more Grand Prix. 247 Grand Prix starts, but this actually is the 250th Grand Prix that he's entered. But after winning 7 Formula One World Championships, it might yet become 8. The big question is, what does he do next?
New profession wanted for 7-time Formula One World Champion. How about working as an attendant in a petrol station? Or playing the Joker in a candid camera show? In the real world, Michael has been offered a management job at Ferrari, but for now, he's planning on doing not much at all.
Who knows what the future will bring? One thing I know is that for a while, I will just relax and take it easy and think about my future, what that could be.
No, I think it's completely open for discussion. And, you know, he's a very capable, intelligent guy with a huge experience of racing, and there's many aspects that Michael could get involved in.
To be off the track for a while won't hurt him, and I'm sure he's busy with, you know, karting, horse riding, travelling, whatever. He has 2 kids to take care for, so enough to do. He won't miss you, I'm sure.
Of course, Michael doesn't have to do anything. Earnings of £30 million a year for the last 8 years means his bank balance is nicely in the black. But his colleagues are sure we haven't seen the last of him.
Yeah, he might do the odd test every now and again, won't he? Might be able to help himself.
You need a rest. But I think after a few months, it's going to be maybe boring.
If I were him, I know what I'd be thinking about. I'd be thinking about driver coaching and stuff like that. You know, he's brought an awful lot into the sport. He's set new standards. And I think he has much to offer younger drivers.
I definitely think he'll be back in Formula 1 because he's a character that fits well into Formula 1, you know, very determined and motivated and needs competition and needs to fight.
But here's something new. Apparently Michael's son Mick has started to race go-karts. It is in the genes, so we could see another M. Schumacher in future.
I think that Michael has a life. He's got kids now, and I know I was talking to him, and the kid's starting to race, and when you have that, at some point you have to call it quits and focus on this other part of your life. And I have respect for him for doing it.
What about home life? Your kids are going to be at school watching this on the TV. Do they know the importance of this race?
They know it's the last one, but I don't think it will change their frame of mind to particular watch it or not, because if they have something better to do, they will do better things.
So while the little Shumis are having fun doing something else tonight, the rest of us will be witnessing a sporting great drive off into retirement.
to be through all the race on the limit and to achieve the best lap times or victories in the same way, you need to work out yourself. I get the very strong mental thing by being more than normally fit. I know that we're all human beings and we all do mistakes, but you have to learn out of your mistakes. And I always have done this, I never have done mistakes twice. I know what you read today is forgotten tomorrow. You always, as a racing driver, look for support, and the support is amazing. But then if you would be in the middle of these people and imagine me going to Italy again and going for a pizza or a restaurant, I'm going to be murdered.
I have never been a person which takes care too much about history. I live in the present and in the future. And yeah, Ferrari attracted me. A lot of people at the time said it was a financial situation, which, believe me, it was not. Since I'm a kid, I have enjoyed to be with four wheels, to compete, to overtake, to race. That's what I like.
If you look at my emotions and the way I have been after the race, crossing the line or on the podium, I think all those pictures will explain far more than I could put in words.
You have people that will like me, and they will always like me, and you have some they don't care, and you have the others on the other side, and whatever you do, whatever is the situation, that will remain.
Michael, the people at ITV, the crew, want to buy you a present to say thank you and farewell into your retirement.
Thank you.
We're fascinated to know what you're going to do to replace the buzz of being a Grand Prix driver, but
we'll see. I don't know it.
Yeah, yeah, I'm got a clue.
But anyway, okay. I'd like to say thank you to you guys and all the spectators from ITV.
Yeah, you got a lot of fans in the UK, and obviously we've enjoyed following you this last 10 years, amazingly. Doesn't seem 5 minutes since you started, does it? Back in.
No, it does.
Is it?
Yeah, I have a lot of memories, so I don't live in this world where time goes by too quick.
Yeah,
I live it pretty extensive.
I remember when we were teammates, you used to call me the old man, but you're older now than I was then. And I promised you that it would come around faster than you did hope.
That's true, yeah. It's funny that if you think on certain people, when I was there in the beginning, I call them old guys.
Yeah.
I'm at the same age now, but the good thing is I don't feel like it.
Yeah, well, no, you don't look like it, to be honest. Okay, what they've brought you is, we thought this was appropriate, really, in many respects. It's red, of course. It's about football. It's a replica shirt from the 66 World Cup, one of the few times I think we managed to beat you. And we know that you love football.
Absolutely.
And we're hoping you're going to accept that on behalf of the ITV crew.
Oh, absolutely do. And
yeah,
I'm more than thankful.
Yeah, okay. I don't know how you're going to get it home, but...
Yeah, I'll find some space. Well, I'm here with my own plane, so...
Well, it's in very good spirit, and it's in full appreciation of what you've done for us. And, you know, we hope we're going to see you around Formula One sometime in the future.
Yes, one way or another, I guess. I'll be coming and visiting you guys.
Yeah, all right, good stuff.
You need to do everything perfect to beat him.
He can't stand for anyone else to win.
He is... gifted but flawed.
Oh, out goes Schumacher!
And tomorrow night, a special tribute program to the great career of Michael Schumacher as we go back over the 7 World Championships and the moments of triumph and the moments of controversy as well. Michael Schumacher, driven to win on ITV1 tomorrow night at 11 o'clock. Michael Schumacher is in the far corner of the Ferrari garage making his final preparations to drive in what would appear to be his last ever Formula One Grand Prix. The helmet goes on for the last time, and at the garage door the television crews are about 10 deep. The photographers are thronging around Ferrari at the moment to the man who's given them so many headlines and so many great stories and so much Formula One drama over the last 15 years. All set to drive in a Formula One Grand Prix for the very last time. Well, it's not just the absence of Michael Schumacher we've got to get used to for next year, but great names like Michelin and Cosworth will be gone as well, and of course Kimi Raikkonen will be moving from McLaren to Ferrari. Louise takes us through the main changes for 2007.
Kimi Raikkonen's not the only man on the move, but whilst the drivers are shuffling seats, some of the oldest names in the sport, like Cosworth, are disappearing from Formula One altogether. It's the final
countdown. Little operation, really, up in Northampton, and what they've more than often punched above their weight. They are racers, and Yeah, the last of the independents, I suppose, in terms of being able to come and showcase their skills and talents, not through a manufacturer, is something which we'll see how that'll cost us, really. But shame they're going. We're living together,
but still it's farewell. Certainly, we believe that Formula One is the highest expression of motorsport. And as such, the people participating in Formula One should have the ability to choose their products, they choose their engines, they choose their brake suppliers, like they should be able to choose their tyre suppliers. That's not what the FIA have decided to do. They've decided to go with a single brand supplier, and we believe that Formula One doesn't deserve that.
Tobacco is a big part of life in Formula One, and especially for our team. Our team was started by a tobacco company, and obviously they've been tremendously good to us over the years. But you know, now is the right time for it to come to an end, and lots of other companies are willing to step into the breach and take their place.
Kimi, it's your last weekend with McLaren. Are you feeling at all sentimental about it?
Not really. I think it's nice to have a last race of the year. It's been a difficult year, and I look forward to finish the season. So, okay, there is a lot of people who have been working 5 years very closely. And one way is sad, but in the end, that's normal life, and sometimes you move on, and things will be good fun next year. It's the final countdown.
I think we'll all be sorry to see Fernando go. He's been a very integral part of the team for a while. But I understand these things, you know, people have to move on, particularly at that age. We wish him all the best, but we will miss him.
And that's one thing that might not change. It's odds on we're going to be seeing a Fernando Alonso World Championship celebration in a couple of hours' time. But at the moment, Mark, all attention on the Ferrari garage and the exit of Michael Schumacher. What do you reckon his thoughts are at this moment?
To be honest with you, I've no idea, but I'm pretty confident, though, that at some point there, the focus would be for him to win this Grand Prix, because that's the man. Every time he gets in a race car, he wants to win, and he doesn't care how he does it, he wants to get to the front, and I don't think today would be any different. But, you know, end of an era, Steve. This is a legend in a race car, and we're about to see his last race.
And he is not in retirement mode, he's in race mode, isn't he? He will be looking at what happens in the opening laps of this race, judging his position and how his tactics might change.
Oh yeah, definitely. I mean, he's analysing every single thing at every single moment, and I'm pretty sure that he'll have something worked out in his mind, how he's going to get down to the front there. He's probably got some confidence to get by a couple of guys into turn one for sure here on this circuit in particular.
It does seem that this will be the last time that we'll see him exit a Ferrari garage in anger. An historic moment. 91 Grand Prix victories and at least a chance of another world championship title. So as Michael Schumacher heads out of the Ferrari garage for the last time, it's the end of a 15-year Formula One career and the end of a year-long battle with Fernando Alonso as well. Ross Brawn of Ferrari and Pat Simmons of Renault have been looking back for us. And what have been the key moments, the turning points of this past year?
There were several events in the year where we didn't win races we perhaps should have done, or we had poorer results than we should have done, and they're the things that have accumulated to put us in this position. So. And I think the engine reliability of Ferrari has been fantastic over the years, so it would be very unfair to point out a particular example, and we don't intend to.
There have been a few of the slightly more well-publicised incidents, you know, the penalties that we've received and that Michael's received, and of course the two engine failures which have played a significant part in the championship, but somehow justice was done and everything was evened out. So I don't think it's a question of looking for one key point, and I think that's what has made this year such a good year, because we've been fighting tooth and nail for a long time now.
Here at Interlagos then, Michael Schumacher on his way to the grid. The pole position man, Felipe Massa, will be leaving the Ferrari garage in just a moment. We can reflect some more on what made Schumacher so great, not only mental strength, but also driving style as well. So how would you compare maybe his driving style to that of Fernando Alonso, and also one of the neatest and purest of them all, Britain's Jenson Button? That's the task for Martin Brundle in his Formula One Insight.
Decades ago, drivers almost seemed to sit on top of their cars, and the way that they turned the wheel and held their head to keep their eyeline through a corner was for all the world to see. Today, they're cocooned in a safety cell of carbon fibre and surrounded by absorbent headrests. It's really difficult to see and understand exactly what a driver is doing behind the wheel. Let's take a closer look at today's driving styles. I'm going to copy a range of current driving styles and with different cockpit cameras show you what's really going on. Let's start with Jenson Button.
Button is classically stylish in his approach, taking a smooth arc through each turn. This generates accuracy and consistency and is easier on both the brakes and especially the tyres. The problem is that the track and car can vary enormously and the driver has to adapt and tolerate a less than perfect balance. Let's try that for ourselves.
Okay, why are we choosing Jenson's driving style first? Well, he's the textbook driver.
The timing, amount and rate of turn of the steering wheel is the key.
Jenson likes to veer smooth on the racetrack. He drives the car like he's pushing a spoon through treacle. He's so smooth with it. He takes the ideal ride. He takes a nice wide line in, picks up the apex, smoothly puts the throttle on, taking as little traction control as he can get away with.
Alonso, on the other hand, is very aggressive at the wheel. Look at this tyre warming effort. He lifts the front tyre clean off the road. In high speed corners, the downforce and grip is so good that the driver inputs will be similar for all. But now watch this next left-hander. He throws it in early, even taking some grass. The back of his car is stuck to the track with this technique. Now watch his hands create horrible understeer on turn in, but he compensates accordingly and enjoys the exit launch. Ugly, but effective.
Fernando Alonso loves to throw his car at the corner, takes great apex speed. The back end seems glued. He's really confident. He's sure what it's gonna do next. There are no nasty surprises for him.
Michael Schumacher is different again. As with Kimi Raikkonen, he likes the car to be very positive on the front end, so that the nose is planted firmly on the apex. They are prepared to accept the back end sliding around and even the brakes locked up. It's hard work, but they then use the slide to help turn the car. This high energy driving style demands a specific car setup and is high risk too.
Raikkonen and Michael Schumacher like to go in on the brake, get the nose in, let the back slide a bit, and then point the car out of the corner and floor the throttle. They'd like to brake and downshift right into the corner and let the back come out of it, then floor the throttle as quickly as they can. They'd like the back end to steer the car.
Drivers tend to evolve their own instinctive style rather than fundamentally changing the way that they do their job. With paddle gear shifts and amazing braking power, they can home in onto a finely tuned system of approaching corners at barely believable speeds.
The ITV F1 website keeps you up to date with all the news and opinion within the sport. It's also where you can get information on our competitions. And last time, for correctly answering that David Coulthard's first Red Bull podium came at Monaco, Mark Caswell won a Sony flat-screen television. But now the big competition that takes us into the new season.
We've a fantastic prize to round off the season, a trip for two to next year's Australian Grand Prix on March the 18th, 2007. You'll be flown down to Melbourne in business class by Emirates Airlines, stay for 5 nights at the Hilton Hotel, and once you get to Albert Park, there's McLaren Mercedes Paddock Club hospitality for Friday, Saturday, and the race on Sunday. There's also an exclusive tour of the McLaren garage, and if all that's not enough, you'll have a 2-night stopover in Dubai at the Hilton Creek Hotel as part of your once-in-a-lifetime trip. So to be in with a chance of winning this great prize, courtesy of Emirates and Hilton Hotels, pay close attention to Kimi Raikkonen.
Who is my boss at Team McLaren Mercedes? A. Flavio Briatore. B. Ron Dennis. Or C. Bernie Ecclestone.
Nice one, Kimi. So that question again. Who is Kimi Raikkonen's boss at McLaren? A. Flavio Briatore. B. Ron Dennis. Or C. Bernie Ecclestone. And the number to dial 0901 293 2020. Or text F1 plus your answer of A, B or C to 63337. Entries cost a pound plus the standard network rates. And lines close Thursday, 2nd of November.
Good luck with that, and we'll see the winner in Australia in March. But before that, it's Interlagos for the Brazilian Grand Prix. We'll be down on the grid live in a few minutes with Massa on pole, Alonso poised for the title, and Schumacher set to run for the last time in anger.
F1 on ITV, sponsored by Shell V-Power. F1 on ITV, sponsored by Shell V-Power.
That wasn't Schumacher's most responsive chassis, but as usual, he got the best out of it. Huge crowds here at Interlagos and a wonderful atmosphere ahead of this Brazilian Grand Prix. Let's take you straight down onto the grid. And I think Louise is with Mark Webber.
Yeah, it's not been a classic season for Williams, has it, Mark? I should think you're glad to see the back of this one, in a way.
Oh, you know, of course, you still enjoy the racing, but it is hard when you see P12, P13, P14 consistently on the board. So, you know, I just want to take the opportunity to thank everyone at Williams at the factory and all the effort that's gone in. Everyone puts the same amount of effort in, irrespective of your performance. So it has been a very, very tough phase, and I was determined to drive for Frank and Patrick. Fortunately, it hasn't really worked out, and I hope Williams does a really good season next year. I hope that Red Bull just beat them, but I hope Williams have a strong season, because that's part of our great industry that we have in Formula One. So Williams should be back there, and I want to thank all the guys, even though they saw a bit of a despondent, grumpy Mark Webber in the end. But every dog has his day, and I hope that we finish on good terms and we just have a good race today.
Well, I hope you can give them something to smile about today. Cheers, Mark.
Yes, so many drivers changing teams and moving on, and Mark, one such is the man on the front row alongside Felipe Massa, Kimi Raikkonen. Interesting situation for him, moving from McLaren to Ferrari. So in a way, it's a kind of all-Ferrari front row this afternoon. But what might Kimi's approach be?
I think Kimi would like to put one over on his new teammate for the future, which is going to be Massa, and obviously let him know what he's got to contend with next season. And I think Kimi actually will have a good, strong race today. I think McLaren desperately need a win. They haven't had a win here this season, and they would like to go away with the win under their belt. But the Ferrari and Massa and the pace of the Bridgestones have been so strong over the course of this weekend, it's going to be difficult to see how anybody's going to get there to beat them.
Well, I'm sure there are lots of contrasting emotions down on the grid with Formula One celebrating new heroes and saying farewell to a lot of old friends, not just Michael Schumacher. And as ever, Martin Brundle is amongst it all.
You couldn't write a better script, I don't think. I love this grid anyway. It's one of the best of the year. The crowd are so close to the edge of the racetrack, and they've got two of their local heroes in the top 10 as well, with Massa and, of course, Rubens Barrichello. We'll try and get a word with them. It's going to be a difficult grid walk today, because shortly Pele is going to be down here to present something to Michael Schumacher, and some of the other drivers are coming along too. Look at this beautiful, beautiful Ferrari sitting here. P10 on the grid, 80 metres behind the pole sitter, the sister car of Massa's up there, and it's an uphill 80 metres too. Difficult grid. You have to put a little bit of brake on so the cars don't roll backwards. Michael's got a challenge ahead of him today, and is he up to it? I suspect he very much is. Now, this car belongs to Michael Schumacher at the end of the day. It goes to his museum in Germany, so I guess he better hopes he doesn't bin it. I just want to find out if there were any problems with the car when he had some fuel issues yesterday that obviously put him back down on the... Luca, test driver Luca Badeau, do you know any problems with Michael's car coming to the grid? Is everything fixed?
No, everything's fixed. We're expecting a very good race now.
He didn't get the fuel running in. Is there going to be a big deficit for him today? Is it a problem?
No, we repaired yesterday's situation. And I think that now everything is okay.
Okay, thanks a lot. Now, the presentation I'm just hearing is down at the front of the grid. So let's see if we can head down there. These BMWs had on the back of them in free practice, thanks, Michael, to the sort of fellow Germans. They've taken that off for today. They've got to stay ahead of Michael Schumacher today. They certainly don't want to be thanking him as he comes past them. He's got to pass his brother Ralph in the Toyota, which we're expecting not to be quite as fast in the race as it was in qualifying. Surely this man Fisichella, I'm going to try and come back if I can to catch some of these people, is going to be, he's got to have the widest Renault in existence. You know, they have that advert with the big backsides on them. Well, he's got to get one on the back of that. He's got to hold up Michael Schumacher. Let's get to the front of the grid here and see what's going on. It's just a sea of people and photographers. Jensen's coming up. What are you going to this presentation, Jensen?
Looks that way.
Yeah, what's going on? What's going on up there?
You know as much as me.
All right, well, let's go and find out then. Right, here we go. Let's have it. We've got to poke. We just have to get Rude in here. Yeah, that's okay. Well, we need to get pictures with this camera. No, you don't understand.
No, I understand.
Yeah, okay. But we can get around the side?
Yeah, over there.
Okay, thanks. Can you find your way through, Andy? So Michael Schumacher's through there, taking a big cup by the looks of it from Pelé, acknowledging the crowd. They're more supporting, I think, Massa today than anything else, but obviously to be here, to experience the great man's final race, that's of course assuming that he doesn't come back and race another time. We'll try and grab him on the way back. Lord Blythe, you're with McLaren today, I believe.
Yes, of course I am.
Good stuff. And you think your man can win the race?
Of course he can.
All right. You seem very certain and confident. Right. Kimi Raikkonen doesn't seem too interested in the proceedings going on up there. Kimi, you missed the presentation by Pelé.
Yeah.
Will you get over it?
Yeah, I was having a shit.
Okay. Thanks for that. Now, yeah. Obviously, you'll have a nice light car on the grid then. So, can you win this race?
Oh, we try, definitely, but it's not going to be easy against the Ferrari, but you never know. We give the best to people.
Now, you're going to Ferrari next year, but I guess you don't care about that at the moment, yeah? You just work. If Michael's behind you, that's his problem?
Yeah, we do our own race, and hopefully we can achieve a good result, and next year's a different story then, but right now we just try to do the best that we can.
Well, good luck in your last race for McLaren, and we're right behind you. And Fernando Alonso, they've all come steaming back. I knew it was going to be a misery today. Alonso then P4 on the grid. He says he was very happy with that. He'll want to be beating his old teammate Jarno Trulli off the grid. Now everybody's wearing the same colour overall, so I don't know. Oh, he's got his helmet on already. We'll just go and poke around and see if we can have a look. I don't think we're going to be able to get in there. Last year he stayed up on the wall so none of us could get to him. I don't blame him. This man could become the double world champion today. Even if he didn't win last year's world championship, he'd still be the youngest world champion of all time. So Alonso then steps into his car. It's brilliant to be down. You can't do this on a football pitch or any other sporting environment. Get right down into the action before the drivers have to go and get the job done. Okay, back to you, Steve.
It is an extraordinary atmosphere down there, quite clearly. And Mark, I think whatever happens in the race from now on, Kimi Raikkonen has given us a rather special moment to remember. But it is a wonderful atmosphere in Interlagos, and we've talked so much about Michael Schumacher. Fernando Alonso is on the real verge of greatness here, isn't he?
He is. I mean, such a young man, as Martin Brundle just said there, looking at getting his second world championship already, and such a great career. And it's astounding, actually, to see somebody like him biting at the heels of someone like Michael Schumacher and accomplishing so many world championships already. But for me, you know, to see Schumacher today and watch the man at work, it's going to be a great pleasure.
but also to see Fernando Alonso as well, hopefully wrapping up a world championship. But 1 point is all he needs, and 1 point is still going to be tough to get.
And the Constructors' Championship also at stake. That man, Giancarlo Fisichella, has a big role to play, doesn't he?
He has a great role to play, and it's been asked of him all season long, and today he must deliver because Renault needs to wrap up their Constructors' title.
So the start's almost upon us, an extraordinary sense of anticipation around Interlagos, and we'll be into the final race countdown when we return. Alonso poised for the title, and only one man can take it from him.
F1 on ITV, sponsored by Shell V-Power. F1 on ITV, sponsored by Shell V-Power.